This is the case of Palestine that we are witnessing now, with the American F-16 air jets mutilating the bodies, the children of Palestine. 33 people have been killed in 2 days, 1/3 of them are children. So this is the story that we should all take care of and try to remember always, the story of the human family, the mankind, because we are all one family. He says that he's a Jew. I have no problem with that. I have always said that. I'm not saying this for like diplomatic reasons to show that I'm tolerant and flexible and whatever. Because when the hour of truth comes, you have to prove the soul of tolerance and the brotherhood with all of the humankind. I have no problem with any religion. I'm a Muslim. I'm a Shia Muslim. I say, we believe, the Quran says that heavenly religions should be respected and should believe in Jesus, in Moses, and in Muhammad, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. If you want Buddhism, you have to respect all people for the religions and that they believe, that they uphold. You should not condemn them or not respect them for what they believe in, because this will tell. I mean, they believe in with sincerity and the truth. When they have the true belief, the authentic, the right one, then they are going to move to it, because it's the inherent instinct, the fitra, the nature of the human beings to love, to be complete, and to continue to live with others in harmony and in peace. The problem that I'm afraid I have to talk about is about extremism, about terrorism, about resistance, freedom fighter. We all know that we have to revisit all of these terminology. We have to come out with the new definitions, definitions that could stand actually. All the international community has not been able till now to come into agreement or into a definition about all of these aspects. So one man's freedom fighter is another's one terrorist. But I can tell you for sure, when I was the chief editor of a news bulletin, it was in English, when the 9/11 attacks happened and some people, fanatics, terrorists hijacked airplanes with civilians, with families waiting for their fathers or mothers, and they crashed them into the towers, in the Twin Towers in New York, actually. We said this is a pure terrorism. This is utterly should be condemned. We cannot take it. We don't accept it. We didn't think twice, or we didn't ask anyone to tell us what was really happening. We believe the American administration is trying to spread hegemony all over, and they are occupying other people's lands, but this will not give us in any way the right to accept or not to condemn these attacks against civilians, against people, because it's not in their names the occupation is taking place. The proof for that is what happened here in London with the march that we were able to see, and the march that we like always to see. And this is an opportunity for me to call upon every one of you really to believe in what you're doing. Your coming and your participation in the 15th of March demonstration that will spread all over the world, it does not mean that you are giving a gesture. It is a real commitment to peace, to equality, to brotherhood, to solidarity with all of those who are suffering under oppression and under occupation. It really means a lot, and we expect you to do and to be many in this occasion. I heard a lot of calls, and I read a lot, and there had been a debate here in the country about coming here. I mean, they wanted to ban me. I wanted to say something here. I've always been for academia and academia, if you want. I mean, either academia or academia. I respect a lot of values in the West. I am a graduate of Birmingham University. I got my PhD degree about the compatibility between Islam and democracy. And I'll tell you simply what was the outcome of my thesis. We love democracy. We respect elite rotation, checks and balances, transparency, elections, regular elections, freedom of speech, and all of these things. They are genuine, they are important, they do not contradict with Islam, but please, you cannot impose. No one can impose his own version of democracy on other countries. Let democracy nurture steadily from within. Do not impose it. I don't believe that any Western country has been able to come out with a single definition of democracy that we can make a measurement for all of the other democracies, because I have some friends here who say Democracy? What's this word? I heard it somewhere. This is elected dictatorship. This is what they call. Is it really? And if it's the choice, what if the majority of the people don't want democracy, for example? It is democracy. Not to accept or to embrace democracy. If this is the choice of the majority, then this is democracy. Then we don't want democracy. I have nothing against democracy again. So, it's not that the West is bad, is evil, or whatever. No. The freedom, the rights, the rule of law is very important. We aspire and we look to have these things in our countries, but not to be imposed by words. I want you to be democratic. I like something that has been written in the back of the cars in America. Don't come closer, I'll bring democracy into your country. And we see what kind of democracy that they are bringing to Iraq and to Afghanistan and everywhere, meddling in their affairs and killing their people. Democracy in Iraq, 1 million people killed. And then we come again to the same thing. They don't want you to come here and speak. Why? Why is the censorship? What am I going to say? They say I'm an extremist or fanatic or with Hezbollah and Hezbollah. Oh, Hezbollah. This terrorist organization. Terrorist organization? It's a resistance movement. I'm older than Hezbollah. I tell you, I was born in 1965. Hezbollah came into existence officially in 1985. In 1982, the Israelis came to our country under a pretext and alibi. It hasn't been proved. Nobody knew about it. They said that there has been attempt against the life of their ambassador in London. And they invaded Lebanon. The large-scale invasion against Lebanon. They killed 100,000 people. They made the Sabra and Shatila massacres with Sharon. I don't know where he is now. I mean, between life and death. So, I mean, they made the massacres of Sabra and Shatila. And then there has been a reaction to this invasion, to this war. They tell me, and I have been called and asked by many in Cardiff, Bristol, Norwich, Birmingham, Cambridge, what do you want to talk about? You want to talk about war? Is there a just war? I have to come and, I mean, to be afraid and to be humble and to try to be shy about what I want to talk about. No, I will not. I'll tell you simply. If you want to tell the people that you don't want wars, what do? You have many things that you can do. You can demonstrate in the streets, voice out your anger, vent out your anger and say I'm against it. You can take measures. But if it's your country, what do you have to do? It's your moral duty. It's your responsibility. And it is your right. A natural right, a human right. It's a human right. It's an international law right. It's the natural law. It's the human doctrine that you have to defend yourself. And you have to protect your country. And you have to liberate it. Our country under occupation, we did not go to any country and occupy it. We did not steal anybody's water or oil or there hasn't been any soil theft from the Lebanese side, from Hezbollah side. They have always fought on the Lebanese territories to protect the Lebanese people and to liberate Lebanese territories from occupation and invasion. Do you call this terrorism? And when we do this, we are sending a very simple message. We're saying that life is too important to us. We love life. We respect life. It's a gift given by God, by our magnificent God, to be free souls, to live in complete dignity and freedom. Otherwise, no meaning for our life. When you are dignified, when you live with dignity and freedom and independence, then this is the life. And if you live under humiliation and occupation and oppression, this is the death. So you better live while your head is up and not live humiliated all of your life. That's why we fight. And we tell them, when we fight them back, we tell them the war is costly. You cannot come and invade. It's not a picnic. You're going to be killed as an invading force and as an occupation army. You cannot come and kill people and ravage the country and go and unscathed and unpunished. We waited a lot. Do you know? There has been a UN resolution 425. It continued to exist and they took it in 1978. It didn't come into, it didn't materialize. So we had the resistance to fight the Israelis. And they were able to inflict the damage and to liberate most of the Lebanese territories in 2000. It was the victory, the year of the victory. And then in 2006, with the July war aggression and invasion by the Israelis, such a large scale aggression by the Israelis against Lebanon. So we fought back, and we were able to liberate our country, and we were able to do all of this. Why did we do it? They tell you, Hezbollah, don't listen to others. Hezbollah is a state within a state. You know, all of the states in democracies, they monopolize the arms. They have the arms. The army should have the arms, isn't it? You expect your army to protect you, not a guerrilla warfare. Why Hezbollah should do it? And why are they doing it? I'll tell you why. This is something just like what dear friend and John has said, I mean, that you don't hear it in BBC and you don't hear it in CNN or anywhere else. When Lebanon was established, when it came into existence, this Lebanon in 1943, you know what was the ideology or the dogma? Lebanon's strength is in its weakness. This was the philosophy that they told us. And because of that, we don't have a strong army. And because of that, if any army is going to be replaced from one place into another in South Lebanon, in the border with Palestine, we have to take the permission of the Israelis. Is this a sovereign state? Then people were left for their destiny, for their fate. And they had to fight for their life, to protect their lives. They brought individual arms to fight the Israelis. And this is what happened. It isn't that we want the arms and to continue to have arms. You're talking about a state of 4 million that is armed to its teeth with nuclear weapons, 250 nuclear weapons. And what do we have? It's demo day. It's primitive weapons that is fighting them back. But I tell you what, we were able to defeat them in the year 2000. We were able to defeat them in the year 2006. You know why? And this is a challenge that I want you to go and dig deep down and search everywhere, wherever you want. I would challenge and defy to say, you will not see any single party, any single organization that has followers, who have devotion to the idea of justice, equality, prosperity, peace, like Hezbollah. I give you the proof. In the year 2000, there had been 10,000 collaborators with the Israeli occupation in South Lebanon. We're not taking the role of the state. Some of them killed our brothers and sisters and families in South Lebanon. We never slapped anyone in his face. We said, let the Lebanese judiciary, the Lebanese state, take care of them. And you know what happened? They were sentenced for 1 or 2 months, and they come back to collaborate with the Israelis. This would tell you about the genuine tolerance that we have, that we don't want to replace any state or whatever. The other thing that I can talk about here, when I talk about Hezbollah, they struck an alliance with the Free Patriotic Movement. I don't know if you're aware about the political landscape in Lebanon. When two persons, two individuals, me and you, any two, a wife and a husband, a brother and a sister, two individuals have a commitment together, an agreement, understanding, call it whatever. What does that mean? You are giving a commitment. You are limiting yourself to a certain agenda. General Aoun, he is the head of the Free Patriotic Movement in Lebanon. He was exiled for 15 years in France because he fought the Syrians. He called the Syrian presence in Lebanon, and let me tell you something. The Syrian presence in Lebanon was according to an invitation official by the Lebanese government. He fought them and they called them occupation. He was sent out exiled to France. Hezbollah fighting the Israelis as occupation. Those two parties, General Aoun, who represent 70% of the Christians, and Hezbollah with Amr, that represent 90% of the Shia Muslims, they joined and they had this understanding, agreement, together. They called it the understanding between Hezbollah and Aoun. And it stood and it continued to exist after so many real tests, after the 2006 war, which was a real test for this. What does this tell you? It's purely Lebanese domestic agenda. They tell you Hezbollah is a tool in the hands of the Syrians and the Iranians. And Hezbollah accuses, with the Lebanese opposition, because we have a stalemate in the country, the other side, the de facto government, that they are pro the West and the Americans. Though they tell them, we have a cabinet, and Lebanon is a constitutional democracy. When you want to take major decisions that will determine the future of the country, then you have to have a consensus among the different basic parties. They don't want it. We have ministers in the cabinet to tell you about Hezbollah, that they call somewhere terrorist organization. We have ministers in the cabinet. We have the largest single parliamentary bloc of MPs in the parliament. We have hospitals, we have schools, we have educational centers, we have OPTs, we have places to take care of the peasants, we have certain centers to take care of the elderly, we have certain centers to take care of the handicapped, of the wounded, of all of these things. So we're talking about a huge social network that take care of the grassroots. In 1996, the Great of Wrath Aggression, such a huge devastation happened when Hezbollah came out in order to rebuild. Hezbollah was able to rebuild the things when the Lebanese government didn't continue to make the mapping of the losses. They built everything, and they didn't differentiate. This is a Christian village, we don't want to build it. We only build the Muslim villages. No. They did it indiscriminately. And they started with the Christian villages before the Muslim villages, to see that we all live in harmony and peace. I don't come here to listen to myself, and you don't come here to listen to yourself. We have to listen and to communicate and to understand each other and to know that we are one human family. We counted a lot on the international community, more than 22 years. It didn't help. You know why? It's the inconsistency, the double standards, the hypocrisy of the international community. When Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait, they brought him back just like that. Israel continues to occupy and kill the Palestinians in Gaza and in the West Bank and in South Lebanon. And they continue their occupation. Nobody cares. Why? Simply because, I mean, we have maybe less valuable blood. It's not, they don't care. Believe me, it's not the shedding of our blood that they care for. Actually, their blood boils not for the shedding of our blood, but for the oil of our countries. This is what they want. This is where their blood boils. This is where they do something. And that's why they went into Kuwait to liberate Kuwait from the Iraqi invasion, but they will never do it with the Israelis in Lebanon, in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank. Now the issue is to liquidate the Palestinian cause. Soon, and I tell you, it's very important for you to go to the streets, soon they will commemorate the 60th anniversary of the establishment of the State of Israel. Israel has suffered devastating blow by Hezbollah and by the resistance forces. The Americans are dragging their tails between their legs in Iraq and in Afghanistan. They have lost huge losses. They want to have any kind of victory. They are trying to do it in Lebanon. Yesterday, they sent their destroyer, a warship called Cole, that was attacked once in Yemen 3-4 years ago. And they are threatening, we want to tell the Syrians and the Lebanese that we are here to support the stability and whatever. They give themselves the right to go over the seas and to do whatever they want, because you know the logic of might is right. And this reminds me with a very telling story that Napoleon Bonaparte was across the high seas and he sees a pirate in his little boat and he asks him, grabs him from the neck, tell me what you do, guy? And he says, I go and attack a boat, another ship, and they call me a pirate. I'm just like you, sir. I attack a boat and they call me a pirate. And you attack a whole country and you occupy it and they call you a conqueror. This is the only difference, that when you make it a gross attack, then it means something. Again, to the story of Hezbollah and the Syrians and the Iranians, I can tell you simply, Hezbollah is more independent as an organization than many of our governments and the states and rulers in the Arab world. And it does not wait for the Syrians or for the Iranians to tell it what to do. I can tell you, Hezbollah is ready to take any help from any country, from any organization, from anyone, independently and without any conditions, to help the Lebanese people. who are under occupation. And they don't want the arms as an end. It's a means to an end. It's the protection of Lebanon. And they were the first to suggest, come, let us put the arms in the national dialogue table in Lebanon. Let us put it and discuss it. And we are ready to do anything about this. But first, we don't have any other alternative. When we are able to produce a defensive strategy to protect Lebanon, to secure it from the Israeli threat, we are ready to quit the arms. We don't want the arms. Nobody likes to die. And nobody likes to fight for nothing. And when you fight back, you tell that you believe in the life. And life is worthwhile, that you want to protect it, and you want to tell the one who is taking your life, I will not allow you to do it. When you go into the streets, this sends a very strong message. Really, people in Lebanon, when they saw the demonstrations during the July War 2006 in the streets of London and everywhere, they felt that they are not alone. Believe me, moral support is very important. It's not only symbolic. It means a lot. They feel encouraged that there are people in the world who have morality, who have blood. They won't accept the aggression, and they will not accept that it goes unpunished. And you have done extremely well with bringing down many governments, not only here, in different European countries. I believe this is the right message to be done. And I believe this is a march that we have to continue and to mobilize and to accumulate and to have experience. We should be many everywhere. And believe me, we should ring a bell one day in India, and we have the demonstrations in the other side of the world, because some humans, some brothers in humanity, regardless of their religion or color or race, they are suffering. This is the moral issue that we should care for. I say what happens in Lebanon or in Afghanistan or in Iraq or in Palestine, especially Palestine, is not an Islamic issue. They tell you Islamic terrorism. Nobody, we never heard about Christian terrorism. If a Muslim does something or if a Christian does something, it does not mean that Christianity is not good. You have an individual who has done something bad. So, it's a moral issue. It's a human issue. It concerns everybody, regardless of his religion, race, understanding, or whatever. And the things that I want to tell you about, they want to ban people from talking and from giving the message to the other people. Now I came and I talked to you, and this is my message. This is what I believe in. I want one day, when we don't have any injustices, when we have equality, prosperity, peace, affluence, tolerance, harmony among all the human family of this world, actually, regardless of all of their race and color and political affiliation. This is what we want to see happening, and I believe we are going to witness many events in the coming month or maybe years, huge events in the area, in the Middle East. We have a turning point. So I believe this would entail you, or this would give you the opportunity to gather and unite more and more, because you have a duty and you have a right that you want to deal with, and you should do it fervently, because it means a lot to us. And I don't hope at any day that you need us to do something similar. Let's hope that this would be the end of the occupation and aggression and oppression. This is the message that I wanted to give you tonight. Thank you for listening to me. Assalamu alaikum.